Let's talk about Assault Lily. Assault Lily started out as an original work as far back as 2005, but expanded with a series of dolls, novels, and stage plays throughout the mid-2010s, thanks to the help of A-Zone International, a former textile printer turned doll producer. The series is the brainchild of Kanei Obanazawa, a former self-proclaimed amateur sculptor and part-timer for A-Zone, who later worked for the company full-time on Assault Lily, as well as Mimi Garden, another doll line of the company. The man himself is fairly reclusive, but he's still somewhat involved with the series, keeping up on social media whenever a new work drops. Assault Lily takes some inspiration from works in the Class S genre of fiction, namely works like Maria-sama Gamiteru and Strawberry Panic, among others. However, the former makes up the bulk of its inspiration, namely in the theme of sisterhood pacts that are affectionately parodied in Assault Lily. The series has a lot to unpack, but here's a condensed summary of its basic premise so you have a rough idea of what it's like. The franchise is set on Earth during an unknown period in the future, but is generally theorized to take place somewhere around 2052. Around the turn of the millennium, humanity is threatened by metallic-looking creatures called Huge, which pushes civilization to the brink of extinction. To counter this, mankind harnesses an energy called Magi, building anti-Huge weapons called Charms. In true magical girl fashion, teenage girls are the best at handling these charms, which leads to the rise of Lilies, who fight to protect mankind and reclaim the world at large from the Huge. Lilies are hosted at gardens, which are schools and makeshift bases that protect the surrounding regions, as well as doing school things. A lot of these gardens, and by extension, a good portion of named elements in the franchise, bear some kind of mythological motif, usually Norse in nature. The focal garden of note in the franchise is Yurigaoka, where a good portion of named characters are stationed, though there are other gardens that do come up occasionally from time to time, like Ludvico, Odaiba, and Irma. Many lilies, but not all of them, have abilities called rare skills that help them in battle, with many gardens opting to focus on training for the less common ones. If you need a comparison, think of it like the class skills in the Fate franchise, though it's not exactly a one-to-one comparison. Most lilies fight in organized groups called legions, which are basically hybrids between informal fellowhoods and military-inspired platoons. Some gardens let legions organize freely, while others organize based on staff or captain choice. However, there are more personal, usually one-on-one oaths of sisterhood between lilies that can be formed, often as a sign of trust. Yurigaoka and Ludvico have the Schutzengel's Oath and Schwester's Oath respectively, involving two lilies of different year groups. The center focus of the series is on LG Rasgris, informally named Team Hitotsuyanagi after its leader, Riri. The team is formed around her relationship with Yuyu Shirai, whose reputation for going berserk under mental duress pushes her away from people out of mutual fear. Yuyu regaining her ability to trust and rely on her friends is an important factor behind bringing the team together during each member's toughest moments, while also serving as a good example of the series' focus on strong personal bonds. This is probably a lot of information to take in, but the main takeaway is that the franchise is incredibly expansive, with over 30 named gardens and somewhere in the ballpark of 300 or so named characters. Assault Lily looks more at personal tragedies and their effects on people in a much different light compared to other magical girl works, instead opting to focus on the disasters of the present. In some aspects, it feels very much like an early mid-2000s super robot show in terms of tone, feeling very optimistic in spite of its grim setting. A side effect of this focus is that lilies and their enemies tend to have a greater influence within the world at large, though some elements do tend to be glossed over quite a bit. Like for instance, why are there shopping malls in the Assault Lily universe? That being said, there are a number of aspects that feel very unique or well thought out, namely in its super diverse roster, especially in Team Hitotsuyanagi, that isn't played for laughs all the time. Quite a few named characters get some relevance despite the large cast, which makes the franchise very interpersonal compared to other multimedia works. A lot of background aspects, like charms and rare skills, are given considerable detail rather than left as afterthoughts, which can create some really cool opportunities for storytelling or future character developments. In many respects, Assault Lily feels very much like Gundam's Universal Century timeline. Both of them are mainly focused on personal tribulations, how characters react to current events in the world, and the relationships people share with one another. There's also more one-to-one comparisons, like how boosted lilies are effectively the Assault Lily equivalent to cyber new types. Many of these aspects are or can be covered in supplementary works, which makes Assault Lily very open-ended, but also leads to a disjointed canonicity of many non-established events. That leaves the million-dollar question of where to start with Assault Lily. There are three main entry points to the franchise, which this video will attempt to cover in as much detail as possible while also trying to remain spoiler-free. So without further ado, here is a detailed introduction to the wonderful world of Assault Lily. The first entry point is the anime and game timeline, which covers the anime, Assault Lily Bouquet, and the gacha game, Assault Lily Last Bullet. This is the most accessible entry point to the franchise, since most resources here are both available in English and somewhat easy to find, at least in contrast to other entry points. Assault Lily Bouquet is a very loose adaptation of the first ensemble stage play, League of Gardens, before diverging halfway through. Any characters who are important to other stage plays are omitted entirely to make Bouquet a standalone work, while some changes are made to better suit this new continuity. The most significant change concerns Team Hitotsu Yanagi's formation, as two-thirds of the team have radically different motivations for wanting to join compared to the stage plays. Yuyu is a lot harsher in League of Gardens, instead of being persuaded like she is in Bouquet, while any mention of Tazusa's background as a boosted Lily is completely cut from the anime. By contrast, Shenlin and Yuja get a bit more focus, performing a hands-on demonstration of their value to the team. There's also an anime-only character who influences some of the show's different plot threads, though she only ever shows up in the latter half of the show. For a starting point to Assault Lily, Bouquet is okay. It's animated quite well for a show produced during COVID, but in terms of story, the show feels very lacking for anybody that wants more, as there's a number of show-only story threads that just go absolutely nowhere. That being said, it's still an okay starting point to the franchise, if only because it's well animated, and is fairly easy to start watching. Assault Lily Bouquet is available to watch on Crunchyroll and Funimation at time of recording. The other half of this timeline, Assault Lily Last Bullet, is a gacha game follow-up to the anime, in a weird roundabout kind of way. It adds and fleshes out the backgrounds of two quote-unquote new legions, Hirensuge's LG Hervor and Kanba's LG Grand Eplay. However, the captains of both of these legions, Kazuha and Kanoho, previously debuted in League of Gardens, but not in the anime. Last Bullet's continuity is blurred after chapter 2 of its main story, because it assumes that stage play events are canonical to this timeline, despite contradicting parts of the anime. The gameplay itself is fairly rudimentary, sharing many of the same problems with another gacha game, Sinnoh Alice, thanks to sharing developers in Pokélabo. Last Bullet is unfortunately Japan only, but the main stories, Legion stories, and some events have been translated by Gehenna Subtitle Labs. For what it's worth, Last Bullet fleshes out a good portion of the existing cast in some way, and it's pretty easy to read some stories on YouTube whenever you have some time left to spare, so do take a look when you can. Also, I forgot to mention this before, but the music is really good, so yeah, that's a plus. The second entry point is the stage play timeline, which is split into a main story, mainly centered on Team Hitotsu Yanagi, and several side stories focusing on other schools and legions. This is the most expansive portion of the franchise, and probably the entry point with the most content. A word of advance warning, the stage plays are virtually impossible to get into without some proficiency in Japanese, though you can get away with Chinese fan subs if that's an option for you, or settle for wiki summaries if they're available. They are legally viewable through DVDs and Blu-rays, though it's worth following the social media accounts to find out where to buy them. The main story covers League of Gardens, The Fateful Gift, and Lost Memories. League of Gardens has a manga adaptation of the same name, subtitled Full Bloom, that's a much more faithful adaptation compared to Bouquet, and has just wrapped up at time of recording. It's available through Amazon JP, plus has an ongoing scanlation over on Dynasty Scans. Additionally, Lost Memories has a summary over on the Assault Lily wiki, though the same can't be said for The Fateful Gift as of yet. Though the main storyline revolves around Team Hitotsu Yanagi, it occasionally features recurring characters from other schools whenever the story needs them, either for the cool action scenes or for the crossover plots. This is probably the easiest section of stage plays to get into, since you can read the manga for League of Gardens and get the partial gist of the overall story through other means. However, it's recommended that you go through League of Gardens before branching out, as some characters and story details are mentioned in other plays. The side stories, colloquially speaking, are three series of plays focusing on different schools: Ludvico, Odaiba, and Irma. There are some details included as references to other parts of the franchise, but it isn't required knowledge for the viewing experience. Because these plays don't have adaptations yet, this section of the video will ignore the spoiler-free rule to outline the important details of each story. Spoiler warnings apply for the rest of this section, or any aforementioned content warnings at the start of this video will still apply. The Ludvico plays are set in the titular private girls' academy, focusing on Sachie J. Fukuyama and her increasing disillusionment towards her school's relationship with Gehenna, the shady research organization that's never up to anything good. There are four plays in total, segmented into two duologies. The first duology, Schwester's Prayer in Secret, focuses on the personal relationships of everyone involved in Ludvico, while the second duology, White Resistance, is split into two parts, Whereabouts of Promise and The Blade of Truth, which shows just how much influence Gehenna truly has over Ludvico. Schwester's Prayer in Secret centers around Sachie's personal relationships, namely with her former Schwester, Mirai Kishimoto, the circumstances leading to her death, and a newfound connection with the latter's sister, Raimu. Though Sachie starts off as distant towards Raimu, seeing her as unfit for Lily responsibilities after Mirai's death, the two of them eventually reconcile and become Schwesters, after learning that Mirai is a boosted Lily during an important battle. There's also an important subplot involving Raimu and Mirai's childhood friend, Seren S. Amamiya, whose desire to grow stronger as a promise to protect Raimu drives much of her character development in this duology. Seren boldly proclaims that she'll only train under the strongest Lily, which eventually gravitates her towards Yuria F. Kuroki, another boosted Lily who turns out to be one of Ludvico's aces. Though the duo initially struggle to get along, they slowly form a partnership in their own weird way. However, Mirai is soon resurrected through Gehenna's machinations, forcing Sachie, Raimu, and Seren, with help from Yuria and Ludvico's elite temple legion, to give her eternal rest, rather than let her be used for a grander scheme. Yuria takes these experiences to heart, eventually taking Seren under her wing as her Schwester, while searching for a renewed reason to continue living in the present day. Following on from this, the White Resistance duology focuses on Ludvico's internal conflicts, as well as Sachie's formation of a new legion, Legion Ironside, to restore some sense of justice and order to the school. The power struggle between the pro and anti-Gehenna factions of teachers, combined with low morale throughout the Temple Legion, creates a divide between students who share Sachie's vision and those wanting to fulfill their duty. While those close to Sachie join Ironside early on despite attempts to the contrary, a number of students are either on the fence or adamant in resolving the matter in their own way. Ironside are prevented from training for their insubordination, which causes an even greater split, and the ensuing chaos from huge attacks leads to Ludvico ending up in ruins by the end of the duology. Chronologically, these plays are set before the Fateful Gift, as the Legion system in Ludvico changes around this point, and part of the school is still trashed from the events of the Blade of Truth. Though it also makes sense by order of original run, as the Ludvico plays do technically predate most of the franchise. The Ludvico plays are one of the first parts of the wider media mix, as much of the franchise's foundations, like rare skills, stem from creative liberties around the budget limitations of these plays. They're definitely worth watching in their entirety, as many have argued that it's a fundamental aspect of the Assault Lily experience. There are three plays in the Odaiba series at time of recording, the singular ability, the empathy phenomenon, and the battle to overcome. They're mainly self-contained for the most part, so you can watch these in any order, though it's worth watching up to the Fateful Gift first, so you can familiarize yourself with a couple of recurring characters, namely the Funada twins. Kito has a notable presence in the ensemble plays, so keep her in mind. The singular ability centers on Haru Hishida of LG Heorot Saints, and her ability to go berserk in a similar fashion to Yuyu. The twins show up to defuse a situation when Haru takes a replacement charm by Gehenna that's designed to make her lose control. The empathy phenomenon takes place while Ui Funada is recovering from a severe injury, and focuses on Kurana Saigo, who loses control of herself during a battle as a runaway effect of her rare skill, Lunatic Trancer. Kurana ends up temporarily transferring to LG Hronus Ness, both so it has enough people to be an active legion, and to find a better solution to her predicament. As a side note, the titular empathy phenomenon stems from the Funada twins suffering none of the drawbacks of Lunatic Trancer. Eventually, a Gehenna agent disguised as the Odaiba staff doctor tries to get the twins to fight each other, but this is resolved in short order. The battle to overcome surrounds the former Funada reserve team, whose former captain, Kanoho, left the school after staying behind to buy for team some time, which gets her best friend Takane horribly injured as a result. The pair transfer to Kanba Girls High School, where they answer a distress call from Odaiba in the present day, leading to the reformation and hopeful redemption of the Funada reserve. These plays are pretty easy to get into, since they require little series knowledge other than basics and a little bit of supplementary context. Do check them out when you have the chance. There's only one Irma play at time of recording, The Gleam of Dawn, that just finished production last month. It focuses on the legions of Irma Girls High School, Ermenshines, and Hackleberand. The plot centers on Himari Ichinomiya, who you might recognize from the Ludvico plays as the leader of its Temple Legion. She was a former Irma ace, but left to form an ideal legion that allowed her to fight freely and beautifully, which is very different from Irma's conservative battle plans. Irma breaks apart at this revelation, with one of its other aces, Komachi Tejima, left too heartbroken to bring herself to fight after the news. Meanwhile, a group of lilies led by Marimo Kamigori and Imari Ueda decide to carry on Himari's will at home, forming the more aggressive and flexible LG Hackleberand. The Gleam of Dawn is set roughly around the same time as the halfway point of the Ludvico story, as many Irma lilies discuss events surrounding Himari and fear for her well-being as a result. Word spreads that Himari is out solo fighting for her life in Yokohama, but Ermenshines is forced to defend Irma against the Cave of Huge, which leaves Hackleberand to squad up and bail Himari out. Another member of Irma's aces, Waku Hibino, makes an oath with Komachi to snap her out of it and fight with Ermenshines, while Marimo and Imari make their own oath after everything else is said and done. The Gleam of Dawn is very easy to pick up, and is widely considered to be a very strong starting point for anyone interested in the stage plays, so if you only watch one stage play, it might be worth watching this one. The third and final entry point to Assault Lily is the supplementary works, which covers a whole bunch of concepts and worldbuilding that gets mentioned elsewhere in passing. Much of the franchise's early content has some fairly different characterizations and worldbuilding info, so it's worth taking it with a grain of salt. There are two major books of note on in-universe events, Assault Lily Glory and Assault Lily Wunder. Glory outlines the background of the Niigata recapture event, as well as the second LG Alvheim, the successor to the legion that Yuyu was formerly a part of. This work is a revision of the Dengeki Niigata recapture novel, with some bonus content added in, but unfortunately there's no English translation at time of recording. Wunder documents the tale of the legendary Odaiba counteroffensive, where many lilies like Yuyu and Sachie earned a reputation for their difficult exploits. It follows the perspective of Misaka Kondo, the uncontrollable lily who later becomes the captain of LG Sangris, as she makes a name for herself through her escapades in the Odaiba campaign. Not only is Wunder freely available online, it currently has an ongoing fan translation at, you guessed it, Dynasty Scans. If you can find translations for any of these online, such as through the Assault Lily Wiki, they're definitely a good read to expand your knowledge of the franchise, so do take a look at them whenever you can, or wherever you can. With a general overview of Assault Lily out of the way, I suppose this is an appropriate time to talk about my own interest in the franchise, and what makes it so interesting to me. It's rare for me to say this, since it often sounds very insincere in today's landscape, but Assault Lily has soul. Watching everyone involved with the franchise, from the actresses to the writing staff, taking immense pride in something very micro-niche, is legitimately incredible to experience. Sure, it has its flaws when it comes to dancing around certain story elements, some more so than others, but I think it's largely forgiven because of how much space there is to address it elsewhere. For all of the technical and financial restraints the series undergoes, it's led to a truly massive world that's refreshingly interesting to go through. Many characters have their own individual charm that makes them stand out in spite of the massive roster, while the world around them feels like an actual environment for them to interact and engage with, thanks to how the school system ties together with its society. There's so much that can be explored with side stories and info books alone that it feels almost too easy to have this much material. But I digress. A friend told me not to end videos on corny, lessons learned conclusions, but I think I'll break that rule just this once. If there's one thing to take away from Assault Lily, it's that the power of human bonds is truly magical. It's undeniable that a lot of passion went into this franchise, and though the end result is something with a rough landing, there's an evident drive to make it cleaner. The girls forming unbreakable connections akin to love with one another while living in a hostile world feels very cliche, but I appreciate that Assault Lily plays with an open hand and continues to maintain a wistfully positive regard for the future. I hope this video is enough reason for you, or perhaps someone else, to give Assault Lily an honest look, and experience what the series has to offer for yourself. Before this video ends, special thanks is owed to Lithica of the Assault Lily Wiki, for whom much of this video wouldn't exist without her insight and consultation. I also extend my special thanks to all the fan translators working on the series in some capacity, as it'd be a lot harder to introduce Assault Lily without their hard work. Thank you very much for watching.
ごきげんよう!